Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. God Almighty, from whom all blessings flow. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. Truly the Lord is good, and his mercy endures forever. Glory to God in the highest, and peace, goodwill to all men. Amen. Good evening. Good evening. Praise the Lord for this Tuesday evening again to study the Word of God together. TNT. Tuesday night teaching. We're going to get into the Word of God tonight. We're starting in chapter 7, the book Breaking the Threefold Demonic Cord of Jezebel. How to Learn the Lies of Jezebel, Ahab, and Delilah. We're going to get into our book where we left off at last time. We're going to be in chapter 7. So this is the book on the screen. We're going to be in this book. We finally made it to chapter 7. We got one more chapter left in this book, and then we'll be done with it. So what I'm going to do tonight, I'm going to open up a word of prayer. I'm going to read a devotion first and then go into a word of prayer. And I pray that those who come up tonight will be blessed by the word tonight, blessed by the Spirit of God. And I pray you had a great day, a wonderful day, a peaceful day. No matter what you encounter or gone through, I pray that you are blessed and highly favored of God, knowing that you are in the will of God as you stand fast in the liberty where Christ has made us free. Amen. It's up to you to make a decision in yourself to maintain a righteous stand in the presence of the Lord, or you fall apart with the things of the world that's perishing around us every day. Amen. Amen. So we're going to get into the devotion and then go into our prayer tonight and then get to our lesson. It says, do not be surprised by the fiery attacks on your mind. That's a good one. Do not be surprised by the fiery attacks on your mind. When you struggle to find me and to live in my peace, don't let discouragement set in. You are engaged in massive warfare, spiritually speaking. The evil one abhors your closeness to me, and his demonic underlying are determined to destroy our intimacy. When you find yourself in the thick of the battle, call upon my name. Jesus, help me. At that instant, the battle becomes mine. Your role is simply to trust me as I fight for you. That is so good. When you find yourself in the midst of a heated battle, heated discussions, altercations, troubles and trials, call on the name of Jesus. And I guarantee he will show up and take control of that battle. My name, properly used, has unlimited power to bless and protect you. My name, properly used, has unlimited power to bless and protect. At the end of time, every knee will bow in heaven, on earth, and under the earth. When my name is proclaimed, people who have used Jesus as a shoddy swear word will fall down in terror on that awesome day. But those who are drawn near to me through trusting utterly my name will be filled with inexpressible and glorious joy. This is your great hope as you await for my return. That is so good. Reference scripture, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 47. Philippians chapter 2, verse 9 and 10. And 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 8 and 9 are the reference scriptures to this devotion. Do not be surprised by the fiery attacks on your mind. So, Lord God, tonight I thank you for your presence, God, in our midst. I thank you as we take the moment, Lord God, to get in your word tonight, that you speak to us by divine revelation. Give us insight, understanding into the mysteries of the gospel. Purify our thoughts and our actions, God, that will align with your word. Forgive us for our sins, oh God, sins of thoughts, sins of actions, sins of the mouth. Cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Remove the busyness from the day, Father, from our minds. And give us clarity and understanding to hear your voice and heed to your word and apply it to our lives. We pray for healing for those in the healing tonight, God. Those who are bound with strongholds, addiction, and bad habits, God, will be set free by the Spirit living God. And we thank you that he who began a good work in us is faithful to complete it until the day of Jesus Christ's return. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen, amen again to the Lamb of God. Hallelujah. So tonight we're going to get into our book, Breaking the Threefold Demonic Cord, How to Discern and Defeat the Lies of Jezebel, Athaliah, and Delilah. That's what we're going to engage in chapter 7 tonight. The Evil Power of Delilah. The Evil Power of Delilah. Amen. Praise the Lord God Almighty. What a wonderful Lord and Savior we serve. Amen. Let me get to my notes. I found something online tonight. It's going to tie in what we're talking about tonight concerning Delilah and Samson Delilah. And I want to talk about briefly the Nazarite vows. The Nazarite vows. We got to understand that Samson was a Nazarite. And according to the law of God, he was not to engage with any other nation outside of the Nazarites or the Jewish people. They were not to marry other from other nations, other cultures. They were to find someone in their own lineage to marry to keep their bloodline going. However, we know the story of Samson, how Samson was attracted to a Philistine woman who was a harlot and eventually married her. So, Numbers chapter 6, it says, Then the Lord said to Moses, give the following instruction to the people of Israel. Now this is God talking. He said, give the instructions, follow instructions to the people of Israel. Give me 1 second, I gotta change my glasses. I forgot, I gotta read these are clearer. Much clearer. All right, much better. Gonna have a computer glass reading from the computer, ain't there something? So if any other people, neither men or women, take the special vow of a Nazarite, setting themselves apart to the Lord in a special way, they must give up wine and other alcoholic drinks. They must not use vinegar made from wine or from other alcoholic drinks. They must not drink fresh grape juice. And they must not eat grapes or raisins. As long as they are bound by the Nazarite vow, they are not allowed to eat or drink anything that comes from a grapevine. not even a great seed or skin. They was never cut their hair throughout the time of their vow, for they are holy and set apart to the Lord. Until the time of the vow has been fulfilled, they must let their hair grow long, and they must not go near the dead body during the period of their vow to the Lord. Even if a dead person is their own father, mother, brother, or sister, they must not defy themselves, for the hair on their head is the symbol of their separation to God. Isn't that something? That's amazing. This requirement applies as long as they are set apart to the Lord. Now that's a vow. That's a serious vow. And that's a commitment to God. And you got to follow a commitment. Otherwise, you're in violation of God's law. And it's better to not make a vow to the Lord and not keep it than to make a vow and keep it. Because you keep a vow to God, God holds you accountable. But if you make a vow and you don't keep that vow, you break the covenant between you and your God, and you cause yourself to be in judgment of God. Listen to this. Verse 9. If someone falls dead beside them, the hair they have dedicated will be defiled. They must wait for 7 days and then shave their heads. Then they will be cleansed from their defilement. On the 8th day, they must bring 2 turtle doves and 2 young pigeons to the priest at the entrance of the tabernacle. The priest will offer one of the birds for the sin offering and the other for a burnt offering. In this way, he would purify them from the guilt they have incurred through contact with the dead body. Then they must reaffirm the commitment and let their hair begin to grow again. The days of their vows that were completed before the defilement no longer count. They must rededicate themselves to the Lord as a Nazarite for the full term of their vow, and each must bring a 1-year male lamb for a guilt offering. This is the ritual, in verse 13, this is the ritual law for a Nazarite. At the conclusion of their time of separation as Nazarites, they must each go to the entrance of the tabernacle and offer their sacrifice to the Lord, a 1-year-old male lamb without defect for a burnt offering, and a 1-year-old female lamb without defect for a sin offering, and a ram without defect for a peace offering. A basket of bread made without yeast, cake of choice flour mixed with olive oil, and wafers spread with olive oil, along with their prescribed grain offering and liquid offering. The priest will present these offerings for the Lord, the first the sin offering and the burnt offering, and then the ram for the peace offering, along with the basket of bread made without yeast. The priest must also present the prescribed grain offering and the liquid offering to the Lord. Verse 18, then the Nazarite will shave their heads at the entrance of the tabernacle, and it will take the hair that had been dedicated and place it on the fire beneath the peace offering sacrifice. And the Nazarite head has, after the Nazarite head had been shaved, the priest would take for each one of them boiled shoulder of ram, and would take from the basket a cake and a wafer made without yeast. He would put them all into the Nazarite's hand. And then the priest would lift up as a special offering for the Lord. These are holy portions for the priest, along with the breast of the special offering and the thigh of the sacred offering that are lifted for the Lord. After this ceremony, the Nazarites may begin to drink wine. So God had a strict order for them to follow in order to become a Nazarite. You have to follow these rules and regulations God put in place in order to become a Nazarite before the Lord, to be set apart and sanctified. What if we had to do the same thing today? In order to be set apart and sanctified for God, we had to have the grain offering, liquid offering, peace offering, all these different things that God had ordered during that time, we all would fail because we are not able in our own strength to fulfill this covenant, this vow before the Lord, without falling short of God's glory. The word tells us, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So we have to keep all of this covenant and requirements that God put in place. God have mercy on all of us. We will never make it. My God. So that's the vow of the Nazarite. That's in Numbers chapter 6, 1 through 21. 1 through 21. Numbers chapter 6, verse 1 through 21. So, I mean, it is really a strict law that God put in place for the people to follow to be a Nazarite. And no Nazarite would consider to be the priest. They were the priests before God. The Levites and the Nazarites. So, let's go on to our lesson tonight. We're going to talk about the evil power of Delilah. God bless those of you who just came on. Thank you for tuning in. Amen, amen, amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. So we're going to get into our lesson tonight. We're going to Judges chapter 16. Judges chapter 16. It's going to be where our scripture is coming from tonight in our lesson. And we're going to find out a little story about Samson tonight. We're going to trust God to give us understanding and clarity to apply to our own lives. Okay, let me put this on the screen. 1 second here. Okay, in Judges chapter 16, beginning at verse 1. We all know the story of Samson and Delilah. We know Samson was a Nazarite and Delilah was a Philistine. And according to their custom, it was important for the man to find a wife. But she had to be one from their own nationality, from their own culture. However, Samson was not serious about following the Lord. So he decided to do what he wants to do, even though he was a Nazarite. He's supposed to be one of those who are set apart for God, but because of his lack of commitment, he allowed himself to be enticed by a Philistine. Verse 1, chapter 16 of Judges. Then Samson went to Gaza and saw there an harlot and went unto her. So in other words, he wanted her. He desired her. She's beautiful. She's attractive. But he did not know the danger and the life history of this harlot. Because this is Jezebel's granddaughter. We talked about Jezebel. We talked about Apaliah, the daughter who had a daughter. And her daughter's named Delilah. So now we're going to talk about the granddaughter, which is Delilah. So Samson saw this lady in Gaza, who was a harlot, who was a Philistine. Verse 2, and it was told the Gazites, saying, Samson is come hither. And they compassed him in and lay wait for him all night in the gates of the city and were quiet all the night, saying, in the morning, when it is day, we shall kill him. Now, they heard about the fame of Samson, how strong Samson is. You find it in chapter 15. And so they were plotting to kill Samson because they knew that he was a Nazarite. Not only that, he's an enemy of theirs. Not only that, he's one called by God. So they said they're going to wait at night to the morning to trap him up and kill him. Verse 3, and Samson lay till midnight, and arose at midnight, and took the doors of the gates of the city and the two posts, and went away with them, bar and all, and put them upon his shoulders, and carried them up to the top of the hill that's before Hebron. Listen to this. And it came to pass afterward that he loved a woman in the valley of Sorek, whose name was Delilah. Ain't that something? He fell in love with a harlot. And that's a shame too, because it's so easy to get trapped up. You're not prayed up and paying attention. But the enemy knows exactly what to do to trap you up. If you ain't paying attention, he trap you up any way he chooses to entice you. It don't necessarily have to be with physical things. It can be natural things. It can be some tangible things that you love more than God. Delilah is a feminine name of Hebrew origin that means delicate. She who weakened. You hear that? Her name means one who weakens. In other words, she know how to get to you to take away your strength. That's something. All this time I never knew that. The reason why she was so cunning and deceptive, because she had the same spirit of her mother and the grandmother. Mm-hmm. And the Lord of the Philistines came up unto her and said unto her, entice him. See where is his great strength lieth, and by what means we may prevail against him, that we may bind him to afflict him. And we will give thee, every one of us, 1,100 pieces of silver. So her people is enticing her to be deceptive against Samson, to find out where his strength comes from. All this time, because you read the story, Samson believed that his strength lied in his hair, in the locks of his hair. But if you read the whole story, you find out in the end, it really wasn't the hair. It was the faith in God. They gave him the strength to defeat the Philistines, to defeat a lion, to do different things that he'd done to conquer enemies, to protect his people. Verse 6, and Delilah said to Samson, tell me, I pray thee, wherein thy great strength lieth, and wherewith thou mightest be bound to afflict thee? And Samson said to her, if they bind me with 7 greens, with that will never dry, then shall I be weak and be as another man. So now he's taunting and playing with her. So he said, you bind me with 7 greens. They were like vines that have not been dried up. It's going to weaken me. Verse 8. Then the lords of the Philistines brought up her 7 greens, which had not been dried, and she bound him with them. Now there were men lying in wait, abiding with her in the chamber. And she said to him, the Philistines be upon thee, Samson. And he brake with the width as a thread of tow is broken when it touches the fire. So his strength was not known. Listen to this. And Delilah said to Samson, behold, thou hast mocked me and told me lies. Now tell me, I pray thee, wherewith thou mightest be bound? And he said unto her, if they bind me fast with new ropes that never been occupied or used, then shall I be weak and be as another man. Delilah therefore took new ropes and bound him therewith, and said to him, the Philistines be upon thee, Samson. And there were liars in wait abiding in the chamber. and he brake them forth off his arms like thread. And Delilah said to Samson, hitherto thou hast mocked me and told me lies. Now there's three times now. Tell me wherewith thou might be bound. And he said to her, if thou weavest the seven locks of my head with the web, and she fastened it with the pin, and said to him, the fillest be upon thee, Samson. And he awake out of sleep, and went away with the pin of the beam, and with the web. So now his hair is bound up, his hair tied up. So he told her his strength is in the hair. And she said to him, how canst thou say I love thee when thine heart is not with me? Thou hast mocked me these three times and hast not told me wherein thy great strength lieth. And it came to pass, when she pressed him daily with her words and urged him, so that his soul was vexed unto death. You hear that? She kept on picking and tugging at him until he finally got weakened. That's what it means, vexed. Weaken your spirit. He was weak unto death. That he told her all in his heart and said to her, there has not come a razor upon my head, for I've been a Nazarite unto God from my mother's womb. If I be shaven, then my strength will go from me, and I will become weak and be like any other man. And when Delilah saw that he had told her all his heart, she sent and called for the lords of the Philistines. These are leaders, saying, come up this once, for he has shown me all his heart. Then the lords of the Philistines came up unto her and brought money in their hands. And she made him sleep upon her knees. And she called for a man. And she called him to shave off the seven locks of his head. And she began to afflict him. And his strength went from him. Wow, ain't that something? That's how the enemy does. If you play with the devil long enough, he's going to eventually find the secret of your heart, where your strength lies. He knows where you are. He knows what's going on in your heart. He knows how to get your attention. He knows how to captivate your attention and weaken you. And so the enemy knew, if I can get him to tell me the secrets of the heart, I can bind him. And that's what the enemy is looking for in a child of God tonight. One who's been playing with the devil long enough, who's not committed to the call, have not made a committed vow to the Lord, who's not serious about walking with God. So he's looking for that person who's weak and easy to be influenced and enticed. In the chapter, we learned of the threefold cord attacking the church. We have studied two of the most powerfully seducing strongholds named in the Bible. The last to expose is the spirit of Delilah. Delilah is the third part of the threefold cord that tries to build death structures over us. Remember that death structures are built upon the past, and the purpose of this book is to expose and overthrow demonic powers that attempt to lock us into the past. That's what a death structure does. It makes your mind a broken record where it plays over and over and over your failures and mistakes, your shortcomings, how you never get things right. You keep doing the same wrong things over and over. Once you get stuck in a system, which is called a death structure, to overthrow your mentality to not be submitted to Jesus Christ's mind. The word tells us, let this mind be used also in Christ Jesus. The enemy knows that I can overthrow you to entice and seduce you to not be serious about your walk with God, he can trick you up by baiting you. That's why I love the book, The Bait of Satan, because that's what he does. He baits us with the things that we love the most to entice us and draw us away from the faith. Delilah is the same way, a demonic power that connects the threefold demonic cord that is not easily broken. If you don't know how to face your enemy, to defeat your enemy, how do you expect to overcome the weaknesses and the struggles you deal with on a daily term? You never overcome the bad habits, the strongholds, the struggles, the addictions, the lies of the devil in your own strength. You never measure up. Because the enemy knows exactly what to do to cause you to break your own vow to God. The word tells us we're heirs and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. Therefore, we are to be committed to serving and submitted to following him. As we read further, you may discover particular patterns of behavior from which the Lord desires to deliver you. This book has been showing me myself from beginning to this very moment, showing things about myself that has to change every day. Every day is a process of dying to your own flesh, your own desires and appetites, the evil passions and cravings of the heart. It's up to you every day to submit to Jesus Christ, resist the devil, and then he'll flee from you. The enemy is not going to flee if there's never any submission. We got to get to a place in ourselves where we hear God speaking to us, follow his voice, obey his voice, let him lead and guide you in the way of truth and righteousness. Amen. Listen to this. Or he may expose generational tendencies that have been opened, that have opened the door to seducing spirits to attack you. That was a really good point right there. A lot of the seducing spirits that have violated your life, a lot of the sinful behaviors and patterns that you have been baited and followed for a long time in your life have come from generational spirits. These generational spirits come from your ancestors who never mastered these spirits, who fell prey to the same evil seducing spirits of the enemy, and the same thing came through the bloodline to attack you. And the reason why you never overcome is because you haven't given your mind to the Lord Jesus Christ to change your filthy thinking. We gotta allow the Spirit of God to transform our minds from the mind of the flesh to the mind of the Spirit. The mind of the Spirit is life and peace. The mind of the flesh is an enemy of God, and it never will submit to God because the flesh is not prone to follow God. It's prone to do evil. My God, my God. I hope this is helping somebody tonight. I don't know about you, it's helping me. Amen. Praise the Lord. God bless you, Pastor Nehemiah. Amen. We got to get to a place in ourselves where we submit to the Lord Jesus Christ and to the Word of God and the Word of His grace, because the Word has the power to transform. The Word has the power to change your inside and manifest outside of you every day of your life when you learn how to listen and obey the voice of the Holy Spirit. The problem comes if we don't listen. We don't listen. We call ourselves listening, but we don't. We follow our own desire, our own flesh, and we give in to the things the enemy put in our hearts to do. Amen. We're going to keep you in our prayer, Pastor Nehemiah. We're going to keep you in prayer that God provide those Bibles you need over there and financial resources to bring increase in your country as well for the ministry. Amen. So we got to recognize what it is that I gave access to open a door into my life. Sometimes it's through peers, through relationships, through generational curses, through the media, through so-called friends. And the enemy knows when you give access, give him one foothold, he's coming in. The word says don't give a foothold to the devil. Because when you give an open door to him, he's coming in full force. But he comes in subtly, in little ways, just to captivate your attention, to make your sin seem pleasurable and satisfying. But all the time, it's a trap to destroy your faith. Whenever the Lord reveals and are built upon the past, and the purpose of this book is to expose and overthrow the demonic powers, whenever the Lord reveals the errors in your life where he desires to minister to you, check this out. This is something we all must do. Be accountable to him. Sometimes, in order to be accountable to the Lord Jesus Christ, when you deal with a bad habit, you need an accountability partner. Someone who can hold you accountable to help you walk the straight and narrow way every day until you're strong enough to overcome that bad habit yourself. The problem comes in, we're too prideful, we're stubborn, we're arrogant. When you know you need help, you don't reach out for help. When God provides the answer what you've been praying for, he puts it in your face and you miss it because you're looking for something supernatural to happen when sometimes it's something just so natural God reveals to get you through what you're going through. Document, underline, highlight, or journal what it reveals. At the end of this chapter, another strategic opportunity to be set free from the powers of darkness that attempt to steal future breakthroughs and victories. You got to be ready to move forward. Allow the Holy Spirit to reveal your heart to you and the things you're dealing with in your heart. Let's move forward and allow the Spirit of the Lord to reveal new truth that will expose the maneuvers of the enemy. You know what maneuvers is? The different ways the enemy try to move into your life undetected. He's very cunning, he's crafty. He knows exactly how to keep you from seeing him at the time you don't want to be exposed. So you feel comfortable in your sinful life. Listen to this. Allow the Spirit of God to reveal the truth that would expose the maneuvers of the enemy so that we are loose from his planned activities. Like God got a plan for you, the enemy got a plan for you. God has a way of escape, the enemy has a way of trapping you. But if you don't pay attention and pray and keep your eyes open, you're not going to see the Holy Spirit when he tries to reveal to you the trap of the enemy. Samson was from the tribe of Dan. No, this wasn't the 12 tribes of Israel, Dan. Like the other Israelites, the Danites never conquered all of their allotted territory, losing all but the regions of Zorah and Eshtaol to the Philistines and the Amorites. At the time, the Philistines had dominion over Israel. This tribe also was strongly rooted in Baal or Dagon worship. Samson's family was from Zorah. His mother was barren, but the angel of the Lord appeared to her and promised her a son who was to be raised a Nazarite. The Lord gave her specific instruction regarding the raising of Samson and declared that he would begin to deliver Israel out of the hands of Philistines. You find it in Judges chapter 13, verse 5. Both of Samson's parents were fully committed to God and were pleased to dedicate their son to him. Both his parents made a choice, a decision to please God, be committed to God, to serve God, and to give their son to the Lord. They raised Samson according to divine instructions of the Lord. No razor touched his head. He was not allowed to drink or wine or and it says, and did not eat any unclean thing. Samson became the hope of Israel. So what he's talking about, he was devoted to serve the Nazarite vow. Samson was supposed to be the hope of Israel, the one that God would use to deliver them from the imprisonment of the Philistines. He single-handedly slew thousands of the Philistines and destroyed their crops. When the Spirit of the Lord came upon him, Samson became supernaturally empowered to slay the enemies of Israel. He became Superman. You know everybody liked the DC Comics Superman? He could fly faster than a speeding bullet, leap across tall buildings, faster than a locomotive, all these different things. Samson was just like Superman in strength. He can overcome anything he set his mind to do when the Spirit of God came upon him. But the problem was, God was devoted to helping Samson, but Samson was not devoted to serving God. We'll find it in a minute. Samson became supernaturally empowered to slay the enemies of Israel. Samson, however, had a weakness, and that weakness was women. How many of you either been that way when you had a weakness towards flesh or the opposite sex or some other weakness that enticed you? Samson had a weakness for women. Listen to this. And that weakness was women, the wrong women. So he had a weakness for the wrong type of women. If he had a weakness for the women, his own culture, his own nationality, it wouldn't have been too bad. But he was defying God's word by having a weakness for something God told him not to even entwine with. Because remember when God gave Moses the covenant to give the children of Israel, he forbid them to marry other nationalities or serve other nations unless they become like them and follow after their idol worship. This is the same thing God gave to the Nazarites. They were not to serve the Philistines or marry in their culture. His first love was a daughter of the Philistines who at that time had dominion over Israel. Who that sound like? Jezebel and Athaliah. They both were leaders. Now the granddaughter's a leader over the Philistines who had dominion over Israel. Samson's parents urged Samson to marry among his own people. But Samson said, she pleases me well. So he'd been entwined in the spirit of Jezebel and enticed by the spirit of Jezebel to want a harlot like Jezebel. Jezebel was a harlot. The same spirit that went from Jezebel went to Athaliah. It's the same spirit that's controlling the granddaughter, which enticed Samson to fall in love with a sinful desire to follow her. So he wanted her. Judges chapter 14, verse 3. Samson's eyes deceived his spirit. He married her, but later betrayed her by the Philistine. And the Philistine, he betrayed her in the Philistines. Let me go to the book of the Bible here for a second. Judges. It's something how the enemy knows exactly what to do to trip you up. Listen to this. Chapter 14. Judges. And Samson went down to Timnath. And saw a woman in Timnath of the daughters of the Philistines. And he came up and told his father and his mother and said, I have seen a woman in Timnath of the daughters of the Philistines. Now therefore get her for me to wife. Then his father and his mother said to him, is there never a woman among the daughters of thy brother among all my people that thou goest to take a wife of the uncircumcised Philistine? And Samson said unto his father, get her for me, for she pleases me well. But his father and his mother knew not that it was of the Lord. So he sought an occasion against the Philistines. For at that time, the Philistines had dominion over Israel. Then Samson went down, and his father and his mother to Timnath, and came to the vineyards of Timnath, and behold, a young lion roared against him. And the Spirit of the Lord came up mightily upon him, and he rent him as he would have rent a kid, and he had nothing in his hand, but he told not his father or his mother what he had done. And he went down and talked with the woman, and she pleased Samson well. So this deception taking place, but it's all in the plan of God. Even though God did not want him to marry this woman, but yet God decided to use her in the plan, in order to free his people from captivity. Timnath is a place in the Bible that is mentioned in the Old Testament and is associated with several events in Israel's history. It is a town in the hill country of Judah, located in Shephelah, a region between the highlands and the coastal plains. Timnath is mostly prominently featured in the Bible in the stories of Samson and Tamar. In Genesis chapter 38, Judah has an immoral relationship with the daughter-in-law, Tamar, in Timnah. Judges chapter 14 through 15, chapter, Samson desired a Philistine woman in Timnah, a place where different people and cultures could mix and interact. So Timnah is a place where people met together with other cultures. So this is interesting because when you find out that God can take any situation that you are entwined in that's not of his will and use it for his glory. His ungodly relationship led him down pathways of heartache and destruction and made him vulnerable to seductions of evil. One might reason that he would run quickly in the opposite direction, away from another Philistine woman. But seductive powers of defiling strongholds entwined him until his defeat. That's how powerful seduction is. It can cost you your life. You keep playing with the devil, lying to entice you. Eventually, he's going to take your life. Take your passion, take your desire, take your loyalty, your dependency upon God, until he weakens you in your faith and eventually destroy you. And he does it a little piece at a time. Remember I talked about how he picks up the armor of God that we have on? He breaks it off of you piece by piece by influences and enticements of the flesh. And once he gets you to a place where he got you under his spell, then he can build the death structure in your mind of all the failures and past mistakes to imprison you in a dark place of bondage. We gotta pay attention, because if you don't be on guard, as the word tells us, you leave yourself open game for the enemy's playground. Samson found Delilah. He seemed to have lost all sense of responsibility, fulfilling his God-ordained destiny to defeat Israel's enemy. Took a back seat to the seduction of Delilah. So his mission order from God, the plan of God, the desire of God to defeat the Philistines, he put in the back burner of his heart. Because this Delilah is now has seduced him. I remember watching Nature Channel, and it shows how a cobra snake can cause an individual to be mesmerized by looking in his eyes. A cobra snake is so cunning and so crafty, it can get you in a gaze where it captivates your attention and spellbinds you. And gets you locked in and focused, you can't turn away. It's like you're crippled. And then it slowly creeps upon you, wraps himself around you, and bites you until it sucks the life out of you. The seductive power of Delilah was like a viper, like a cobra. It had bitten him. To now is sucking the life out of them, to find out where your real strength comes from. Delilah, the delicate one. Delilah, the delicate one. Remember I said her name means delicate? It means to weaken? Yeah, right. Besides Jezebel, Delilah is probably the most evil seducer of God's anointed. Delilah lived close to where Jezebel was born, so she was prey to the same spirit and seductive tendencies as Jezebel and Athaliah. The difference was that Delilah was not a murderer. She was motivated by the love of money and the spirit of mammon. Didn't Jesus tell disciples to not to be a lover of mammon? He said, you can't serve two masters. You're going to serve one and hate the other. Because you have to make a decision every day of your life who you're going to serve. And who's captivating your attention? Who's speaking in your ear gate? Who's drawing you and baiting you? Hers is motivated by the love of money. There's a lot of leaders in the body of Christ who have the same spirit. The love of money is the root of all evil. Because once it entices you and baits you, you have an excessive appetite. which stems from the spirit of Jezebel. For you can never have enough. You gotta have more and more and more, and you're never satisfied until you die. Remember the story of the rich man and Lazarus? The rich man had everything he wanted. Decided one day, I have so much treasures, I don't have enough room for it. So I'll tear down my barns and I'll build some new ones to store all my goods. Right? The rich man was selfish and prideful. Lazarus was a beggar who laid at his door, just wanting the crumbs from his table. And it said the dogs would come and lick his sores every day. And the rich man would not even give him a crumb from his table. But one day, the Lord told him, tonight your soul is required of thee. The rich man dies. Lazarus dies. Lazarus taken to the bosom of Abraham. The rich man died with the hell. So what good did it do for him to be a lover of treasures, a lover of money? Because he couldn't take it with him. So if you're one of those who is selfish and always thinking about yourself, always wanting more and more and more, don't care what God is telling you to do to help somebody else, you're going to die and all your possessions going to go to somebody else. They go to anybody, saved or unsaved. We all going to stand before the bema seat of Christ, the judgment seat of Christ, and he's going to say, what did you do with my son? When Jesus Christ came to you to give you life and more abundantly, did you receive him or did you reject him? She wasn't a murderer, but she was a lover of things, money, materials. It was easy then for the Philistines to hire Delilah to betray and destroy Samson. Who does that remind you of? Jesus had 12 disciples. One was a deceiver. He was a thief. But Jesus used him anyway to be a follower. Judas. Because Judas didn't care nothing about anything else but the money. That's why he took from the treasury himself. Every time they got money, he took some for himself. So Delilah is one of those who be enticed with money. So I'll do anything for money. Okay, sure, just give it to me. You got people in the church today who do anything for money. If it means lying on you, being deceptive, cheating, whatever it is, if you got the right amount to give me, you can win me over. When Samson rose in power, he was to treat, not, excuse me, he was a threat to every tribe and nation to protect their region in military strength. Five Philistine kings offered Delilah a bribe if she would conspire with them to bring Samson to his knees. My, ain't that something? Five kings came with a conspiracy to deceive Samson through Delilah. And Samson's mistress, her assignment was to discover the secret of his enormous strength and then weaken the strength. So that's her strategy. That was her assignment. To find out how to get his strength weakened so they can kill him. Because as long as Samson lives, he remained a threat to the enemy. Judges chapter 16, verse 5. Entice him, and see wherein his great strength lies, and by what means we may prevail against him, that we may bind him to afflict him, and we'll give thee every one of us 1,100 pieces of silver. Judges 16:5 emphasis, mine, Delilah was being hired to entice Samson, means to lead on by exciting hope or desire, to lure or attempt. See, where his great strength lies, she was examining his strength so the kings could target and destroy his strength. Find out how the kings could prevail against him. Prevail means to prove superior in strength and power. Bind him. One of the definitions of bind is to imprison. So she was enticed to see, find, and bind. That's something. And then afflict him. Afflict translates as to oppress, humble, be afflicted, be bowed down. So she had to do all of this to trap him in an imprisonment by tricking him to tell her the secrets of his heart, in order to destroy him. Entice, see, find, bind, and afflict. Delilah manipulated Samson until she got her answer. God has promised to give Samson strength only if he kept the Nazarite vow. You hear that? God promised to give Samson his strength as long as he kept the Nazarite vow. When Delilah learned this, she cut his hair while he was sleeping, and his strength left. The Philistine then bound him and put out his eyes. He was taken into Gaza, the city of the Philistine giants, totally humiliated and shamed. Humiliated and shamed. Isn't that something? The strong man who once had slain thousands of his enemies was now their slave, bound in chains and grinding in prison house. Talk about a lockdown. Thus, a man anointed with God's might was seduced by a woman employed by idol worshipers and reduced to lowly slave. Interesting, Delilah's name means translated as delicate, but its roots means to be brought low, to hang down, and to be languished. And languished means slow, lifeless, fatigue, weak, lacking in spirit, and listless. As her name indicates, Delilah brought Samson low and weakened him. Satan sent Delilah to steal the strength of Samson. He chose who appeared outwardly to be a delicate, but who had a heart full of evil intentions. She was pleasing to the eye, maybe even fragile and dainty. Her evil intentions, however, were manipulation and seduction, adequate weapons to drain the very life from the strongest man of God. Samson, who was seduced by her delicacies, was at one time a spiritual Hercules, courageous and larger than life, in action indeed, yet in the clutches of Delilah. My God, reduced to weaknesses, slowness, and lifelessness. He was brought down and made low in the sight of all who observed his decline. Wow, that's something. All because he gave in to a seducing spirit. Called him to lose his sight, lose his strength, lose his fame, loses character, his integrity, all was jeopardized, all because of a seducing spirit. We're going to stop right here and we'll pick up next week where we left off at tonight, page 148 in the book. And we're going to continue to see how God prevails against the Delilah spirit. If you've been victimized by a seducing spirit, I have at one point in my life, many believers have in the body of Christ. If you don't believe it, check your record. You find that somewhere down your lineage, you've been victimized by a seducing spirit. And that spirit is deceptive and it camouflages to look normal. But all the time it's abnormal. It does everything in its power to strip you of your strength. Because the enemy doesn't want you to know who you are and what God has called you to be in your life. But once you realize that you've been seduced by the enemy, you have denounced that spirit, rebuked that unclean spirit, anoint yourself with oil, cast that spirit out, fast and pray sometimes, allow the Holy Spirit to empower you to overcome the struggles, the weaknesses, and the seduction of the enemy that has held you in captivity, that you can be set free by the power of the living God. Amen. So I pray this encourage you tonight. Study your word. Get in the book. Get in the book. If you got this book. Because I tell you, when you begin to really see in the light of the truth of God's word, it's liberating. It's liberating. This is the book we've been studying out of for the longest. And I pray that you get this book, you don't have it, add to your library. Because it has a lot of enriching tools in there to open up our eyes to see what God has for us. Now God has the power and the ability to set you free from the inside out. It's up to you to make a decision, a decisive decision, that you're not going to be victimized any longer by the enemy. So it's up to you to make a decision that I'm going to allow the Spirit of God to convict my heart to change, to do better. If you want to do better, you're going to practice doing better. You're going to try to live better. But if you're not real with it, you're going to go through the motions, continue to be deceived, manipulated by the enemy, and enticed by the enemy, and live a superficial life. But tonight we can break the cycle. For what you just heard tonight about Samson and Delilah, God wants to open your heart tonight for you to examine yourself to see where you are in your faith. So I encourage you tonight, just pray this simple prayer with me. We all can pray this prayer. Going to help all of us make a decision to turn. Last night I was had a dream, and the Lord spoke to me in this dream. I don't know where I was at in the dream, but I was someplace, and I heard the voice of God speak, said, "If my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, forgive their sins, and heal the land." And the Lord said, the healing takes place through repentance. If my people will humble themselves to repentance, to turn from their wicked ways, then I can heal them. He said, I can't heal if they don't repent. And that was in a dream. And I knew God was talking to me as well as talking to many others. Because we all have some bad habits and some strongholds that God wants to break off our lives. But if you're not real with yourself, you want to hide behind your secret sin, go ahead. Keep on doing it. Because one day, you're going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ. And when you stand before him, Would he say, well done, my good and faithful servant. Come take your seat in the place of royalty in the kingdom of God. Or say, depart from me, I never knew you. So tonight I want you to pray this simple prayer with me. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, I come before you, acknowledging that I have sinned and sinned against you only in heaven and in earth. I ask you, Lord God, to forgive me for all my sins, known and unknown sins, and cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Come into my heart, be my Lord and Savior. And I thank you for saving me and giving me another chance to practice doing right. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. You prayed that prayer. Amen. You prayed that prayer. You just got born again. Something on my computer. My thing is tripping. My live just went out for some reason. But I pray that you are blessed and highly favored of God. It's a connected streaming source. What kind of mess is this? Well, you all have a great night. And Lord, keep you in his will. Lord, bless you. Make his face shine upon you. May the Lord give you peace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. What just happened to my life?